Clinical studies often give conflicting results, and statin studies are no exception. So when two articles hit my inbox at the same time giving conflicting information about the safety of statins, I wasn't surprised, but what surprised me is what I found when I dug a little deeper. Stay tuned. It's not unusual to get conflicting studies, especially when things are on the edge of statistical significance. I mean, that's actually not a weakness of science. It's part of the beauty of science. You have a study, you have people try duplicating the study, you learn things like maybe your target population was different from one study to the other. So when I got these two different headlines, two different articles in my inbox, it didn't really surprise me. The first was from MedPage Today. And the article said, highly potent statin stands out for diabetes and cataract risks. And the subtitle said, a head-to-head comparison of rosuvastatin, that's Crestor, for those of you who aren't used to the generic names, versus atorvastatin or Lipitor in the LODESTAR trial. So these trials usually have some fancy name just to make them more memorable. The other headline I got was from the science section of an Australian news organization, I guess it is, called Mirage News. And it says, research confirms long-term safety and efficacy of two popular statins. So here we have one saying that there's diabetes risk and cataract risk, and the other one saying that there is long-term safety. I'm really interested in seeing what these two studies are and seeing if they're comparable, seeing if they're talking about the same populations, that sort of thing. So first, let's look at the one that talked about new onset diabetes and cataracts. Here's the headline still. And the article, this is just an extract from a much longer article. It said two high-intensity statin regimens showed similar clinical efficacy. Okay, they're similar. Doesn't mean it's good or bad, but they're similar. When directly compared in secondary prevention, so that's important. We're talking about people who have cardiovascular disease risk already or already had a cardiovascular event. But one was associated with a greater risk of diabetes and cataracts. As for safety, this is a few paragraphs later, the rosuvastatin or the Crestor group had a higher incidence of new onset diabetes, requiring initiation of diabetes medication. I thought that was an interesting thing. I highlighted that. So they say it's 7.2% for Crestor versus 5.3% for Lipitor. The hazard ratio, the difference between the two, is 1.39. And the confidence interval shows that, yeah, this is not likely due to chance, though there is a wide range on what the difference actually is. And then they go on to also mention the cataract surgery, which was a much lower level. Very interesting. I dug down and I actually found this study, and here it is, pretty much what's been reported here. It's rosuvastatin versus atorvastatin in adults with coronary artery disease, and it was a secondary analysis of the LODESTAR trial. So I, from what I can tell, is there was this LODESTAR trial, and then somebody went back in and they said, well, let's analyze this a little bit more with something else in mind. I was interested especially in this, why did they call out requiring initiation of diabetes medication? So I had to go a little bit further into the supplementary material. And the supplementary material is actually very interesting. If you can follow the links and actually find the supplementary material, a lot of interesting statistics in there. And you see that the secondary outcomes, as they call it, new onset diabetes, 7.1% of the people. But the problem is, in the group, about a third of the people in each of the groups already had diabetes, so they're not eligible, so to speak, to get diabetes for the first time. And the new onset diabetes was actually 10.5%. All I'm supposing here is that, and that's 10.5% for the Crestor, 8.4% for the atorvastatin or the Lipitor. All I'm thinking here is, well, maybe they tried treating some of these people with dietary changes, and for some group, it didn't work. And those are the ones who are called out as requiring the initiation of diabetes medication. I mean, to me, the value of interest is, well, how many people develop new onset diabetes when they were taking Crestor or Lipitor? Now, one of the problems with this is that there is no control group to tell us a group that's untreated and has this characteristic age being on secondary prevention and all that, how often do they get diabetes just through the normal course of things as they age? That's not available. Another thing that's not pointed out is that risk, that 10.5% risk is in 3 years. So if we were to extrapolate that, that's about 31% in 10 years. And for the atorvastatin group, it's somewhere around 24% in 10 years. That's actually quite high, but we really can't pin all of those on the statins because, like I said, we don't know what the baseline rate would be. It's not a criticism of the study. They were just comparing the two statins and to see which one had more diabetes and cataracts associated with them. They weren't probably looking for those specifically. They were looking for all different side effects, and these are the ones that stood out for them. So now let's look at that second paper that I got. And that one was the one that said the research confirms the long-term safety and efficacy of two popular statins. Two widely used statins, rosuvastatin and atorvastatin. Okay, this is good. They're talking about the same two statins that that other one was talking about. They're equally effective at preventing heart attacks. We might argue they're equally ineffective because this isn't telling us how effective or ineffective they were, but just they're about equal. In people with coronary artery disease, so this is good too, because now we got this study that's also talking about the same group of people. But while rosuvastatin treatment is associated with lower cholesterol levels, it also carries a higher risk of developing type 2 diabetes. So this is sounding really familiar here. So then a few paragraphs later, down near the conclusion, the researchers acknowledged several study limitations, including that a 3-year study period may have been relatively short to find longer-term effects. Well, my previous video, I talked about how I didn't even notice them until after 3 years, and it was several years after that before I realized that they were caused by statins. So by definition, this was too short. Authors of the paper said these findings should be interpreted with caution. Yet the headline says they confirm the long-term safety. So I'm wondering what is going on here. Read further in the article and it says rosuvastatin was associated with lower LDL cholesterol levels, but it incurred a higher risk of new onset diabetes requiring anti-diabetics in cataract surgery. This is sounding very familiar. So I dug down and sure enough, when I found what the underlying paper was they were describing, it was the same one. So I didn't really get articles on two different studies showing contradictory things. I got contradictory articles interpreting the same study. Two conflicting studies? Well, no. The MedPage Today article pointed out what the risks were. Yet this headline from Mirage News really wasn't even supported by the article itself. Sometimes I think, you know, maybe an editor wrote the headline and the person who wrote the article probably had very little to say in it. Well, this headline here in MedPage Today, that was actually news. This headline in Mirage News, it totally missed what the study said. It outright misrepresented it. So why is this important? Well, you've got to ask, what is your doctor doing? I think about my doctors. They come and they saw me for 20 minutes, then they are scurrying on to the next patient. They were seeing 3 or 4 patients an hour, 8 hours a day, 5 days a week, maybe 6 days a week in some cases. They're probably seeing 100 to 200 patients a week, see them 3 times a year. Well, they probably have a patient load of about 2,000 patients. And it's not just people who are talking about statins. If it was one subject, that would be one thing. But they're just going in so many different directions at once. I really feel for them. And I can't imagine that they have a lot of time to read research papers. My guess is most of them, they get home and they're exhausted. They want to spend time with their families. For those who are able to read the research papers, well, kudos to them. That's a great thing. But are most of them maybe reading, I say popular press articles here? Well, MedPage Today is actually geared towards, at least somewhat towards medical professionals. And if you read MedPage Today articles, you'll usually get a better view of things if you're a medical professional, though not always, and I'm gonna come up with a counterexample in a moment. Or are they just skimming the headlines and they read one like this that says the research confirms the long-term safety of popular statins, file that away in the back of their heads, or maybe they jot it down somewhere. So the next time a patient comes by and says, well, I'm concerned about the long-term safety, and they'll say, well, there was a study that confirmed the long-term safety of these statins. So what are you gonna do as the patient? Well, you have to actually take it upon yourself to chase these things down and read the articles, because believe me, quite often what the underlying study showed is not what the headline says. And here's another example, and this is actually from MedPage Today, and it's the one I've talked about before. And if you're interested in this, the link is up to the side here on my analysis of the Sampson trial. That headline that 90% of statin complaints are nocebo effect was not justified by the study. And if your doctor actually read the study and they didn't do it with a critical eye, they may actually accept that 90% value. That article, the original study, had to be read critically and you had to see what they were really doing. And they took data that was corrupted and they mashed it all together. Watch my other video for the details on that. There was an editorial in the Journal of the American Medical Association in which the Sampson trial was originally published. They said how elegant the design was, but they did list some of the limitations of it. Well, the design may have been elegant, but the execution of it just didn't justify the analysis that they did. They actually could have gotten some really good data out of that, and there is undoubtedly a nocebo effect. It's nowhere near 90% of the statin complaints. I saw it as closer to 20 or 30%, and that was for a select group that was in a situation where they were likely to have a higher percentage of nocebo effects, just because of the nature of the study. That's just another one of those examples where just reading the headlines is going to give you an absolute incorrect impression on the safety of statins. So that's why I think it's important that we take all the headlines with a grain of salt. That MedPage Today with the 90%, that was propaganda in the sense that the article or the study that it was derived from became propaganda once they started misinterpreting the results of their own study. If you appreciate this content, please like, share, subscribe, and comment on this topics or others you'd like me to cover. And if you haven't seen this video, I recommend you take a look at it now. Thanks for listening.